Hi there. This is an analogy to explain why vertical and torsional diplopia occurs in unilateral and bilateral fourth nerve palsies and how to diagnose it at the bedside using the head tilt test. Normally at rest, all the six extraocular muscles are tonically active. Half of the muscles oppose the other half, and in that process, the sum action of all the muscles keep the eyes in primary gaze where it is looking straight ahead. The extraocular muscles in the analogy are shown by the blue rubber bands with their initials next to them. The horizontal recti muscles are not shown as they're not relevant for the purposes of this specific analogy. The extraocular muscles act along their main line of pull. This is not the same as the muscle's site of origin. For analogy purposes, the muscles are shown to attach to the pupil and not the globe of the eye. The resting pull of the two muscles that elevate the eye, being the superior rectus and inferior oblique, is equally matched by the resting pull of the other two muscles that depress the eye, being the inferior rectus and superior oblique. These together make the eyes remain in the center at rest. The yellow and green cross on the pupil indicates the amount of rotation or torsion of the pupil. Intorsion is when the top of the eye moves towards the nose. Extorsion is when the top of the eye moves away from the nose. Torsional eye movements are important to help you make sense of the world around you when your head is tilted in the coronal plane, so that you can maintain the object of focus on your foveae. It is important to note that in neutral head position with the eyes in primary gaze, the extraocular muscles have equal intorting and extorting forces that cancel each other out, leading to no eyeball rotation at rest. This is represented in the analogy by the rubber bands pulling against each other equally, and in that process, the cross does not rotate. The patient view in the top right corner shows a horizontal red bar that the patient is being asked to look at. When the patient tilts their head, the red bar does not move, but from the patient's perspective, the bar will rotate proportionally to the amount of head tilt. For clarification, the view of the patient's face is as if you are looking directly at them as an examiner. The patient view is what the patient's visual experience is. This has been highlighted by the right and left notation on the patient's face and the red bar. The ocular torsion that occurs when the head is tilted will be slowed and broken down to help understand what happens normally. When the patient tilts their head to the right, their eyes need to rotate proportionally to the amount of head tilt. For this, both eyes need to rotate clockwise from the examiner's perspective, where the right eye will rotate towards the nose, which is intorsion, and the left eye will rotate away from the nose, which is extorsion. Looking at the right eye and seeing the rubber bands pull on the right pupil, when the rubber band representing the superior oblique is pulled, it pulls that part of the pupil it is attached to towards itself, which turns the pupil clockwise. At the same time, the rubber band representing the superior rectus also contracts, pulling that part of the pupil it is attached to towards itself and rotating it clockwise also. In this process, the right superior rectus and superior oblique turn the eye towards the nose, causing intorsion of the right eye. A similar process occurs with the left eye, where the inferior rectus and inferior oblique pull part of the pupil that they are attached to towards themselves, and in the process, the left pupil rotates clockwise, but this time due to the position of the muscles, the eye rotates away from the nose, causing extorsion of the left eye. The contraction of the muscles is indicated by the blue rubber bands becoming shorter and thicker. Looking at the patient view, on tilting the head to the right, the red horizontal bar appears to the patient to be tilted, where the right side of the bar is higher than the left. When the head returns back to neutral position, the superior named muscles of the right eye and inferior named muscles of the left eye relax, and the eyes return back to primary gaze with no torsion. When the patient tilts their head to the left, the same process happens in a mirror image. This time, the right eye needs to extort to maintain visual alignment, which is done by the right eye's inferior rectus and inferior oblique muscle. The left eye needs to intort, which is done by the left eye's superior oblique and superior rectus. In summary, head tilting causes the eyes to counter-roll away from the tilt. The superior named muscles act to intort the eyes, and the inferior named muscles act to extort the eyes, regardless of which direction the head is tilted to. In real time, when the head tilts, the eyes create smooth, uninterrupted torsional movements that help us make sense of our external environment. This ocular counter-rolling opposite to the direction of the head tilt is made possible by the vestibulo-ocular reflex. The trochlear nerve has the longest intracranial course of any nerve, which makes it particularly prone to injury from head trauma or changes in intracranial pressure. The trochlear nerve supplies the superior oblique muscle, which is covered in a previous video on extraocular muscle actions. In short, its main muscle actions are to depress the adducted eye and intort the abducted eye. If the right fourth nerve is damaged, it will lead to a right superior oblique palsy. This is shown in the analogy by the right superior oblique rubber band falling down. When this happens, two major things occur. Firstly, one of the normal actions of the superior oblique is to depress the eyeball at rest, which alongside the other three vertically acting extraocular muscles cancel each other out in order to keep the eye centered. As the superior oblique is now lost, there are now two muscles elevating the eye, but only the inferior rectus muscle left to depress the eye at rest. This means the right eye is hypertrophic at rest due to the pull of the eye elevators outweighing the depressor. Secondly, the other normal action of the superior oblique is to help intort the eye at rest, which alongside the other three extraocular muscles with torsional actions cancel each other out, keeping the eye centered without any torsion. As the superior oblique is lost, there are now two muscles extorting the eye, but only the superior rectus muscle left to intort the eye at rest. This means that the eye is extorted at rest due to the pull of the extorters outweighing the intorter. This combination of the hypertrophic and extorted right eye means that the right and left eye visual fields are misaligned, creating a vertical and torsional diplopia. This is seen in a patient view by the two horizontal red bars. The fainter bar that is lower and tilted rightward is a false image created by the right fourth nerve palsy. Of note, the hypertrophia is not always evident and will often need to be brought out by the head tilt test. If the head is tilted to the right eye needs to intort to maintain ocular alignment as previously discussed. As the superior oblique is gone, the only other intorter is the superior rectus. This can partly intort the right eye, as seen by it intorting slightly. However, at the same time that the superior rectus acts to intort the eye, it inadvertently performs its other action, which is to elevate the eye. This aggravates the hypertrophia and makes the vertical diplopia worse. This is seen by the marked separation of the true and false image from the patient's perspective. There is no problem with the left eye, which extorts normally. This worsening of the diplopia on head tilt testing to the affected side is seen in up to 96% of patients. This is referred to as a positive Bielschowsky's head tilt test, named after the German ophthalmologist Alfred Bielschowsky. If the head is now tilted to the left, the right eye does not need to intort but needs to extort. As the right inferior oblique and inferior rectus are functioning normally, right eye extorsion is normal, and so tilting the head away from the affected side significantly minimizes the diplopia, almost removing the torsional diplopia component. However, as the right eye is still hypertrophic compared to the left, there will be a mild vertical diplopia with the false image seen below the true image. In order to remove the diplopia completely, patients can tuck their chin down in this position, which, when looking straight ahead, acts to elevate the eyes above the horizontal plane thanks to the vestibulo-ocular reflex. This means that the unaffected eye rises up so that its visual field aligns with the hypertrophic right eye, which can remove the diplopia entirely. This is not shown in the analogy. Around half of patients habitually tilt their head and tuck their chin down away from the side of the lesion. If the fourth nerve palsy is congenital or long-standing, old photographs may show this compensatory contralateral head tilt. Additionally, some patients may subconsciously close one eye when reading. This is because looking down and in makes the diplopia worse, as this is normally the optimal working position of the superior oblique muscle. In children, this head tilt may be misdiagnosed as torticollis. If a patient with a right fourth nerve palsy looks to their left with their head in neutral position, the right eye will become more hypertrophic, which worsens the diplopia. This is because the right eye needs to look leftward, which is done by the right medial rectus. In this adducted position, the superior oblique normally works as a main eye depressor, which is balanced against the inferior oblique, that is the main eye elevator in this position, which cancel each other out so that the eye is not vertically deviated. However, as the right superior oblique is gone, the inferior oblique is unopposed in lifting the eye higher, which is why contralateral gaze worsens the diplopia. This is not shown in the analogy as the horizontal recti muscles are not shown. For further information, you can see the extraocular muscle actions analogy video. The arrow sign is a simple and quick way to check which side the fourth nerve palsy is on. For this, you hold a long straight object, such as a tendon hammer handle, horizontally in front of the patient and ask them to tell you how the images are tilted. The two images will converge on the side of the fourth nerve palsy, which creates an arrow that points to the affected side. In a patient view, it can be seen that the right parts of the bar converge to create an arrow, which confirms that this is a right fourth nerve palsy. Occasionally, following head trauma, there can be bilateral damage to the fourth nerve. This tends to occur as both the fourth nerves exit the midbrain posteriorly and cross each other before moving anteriorly, making this crossing point vulnerable to traumatic damage. Sometimes the bilateral fourth nerve palsies can be asymmetric, where one side is affected more than the other. Unfortunately, this can incorrectly be called as a unilateral fourth nerve palsy, which when surgically corrected might unmask the other fourth nerve palsy. And so, in traumatic cases of fourth nerve palsy, it is helpful to suspect bilateral fourth nerve palsies, even though it appears as if it is unilateral. This animation will assume symmetrical bilateral fourth nerve palsies. When both the fourth nerves are damaged, both eyes will be hypertrophic. This means both eyes are vertically deviated to the same level, which will cancel out any vertical diplopia. However, as both eyes are now extorted at rest, there may be a torsional component to the diplopia as seen in the patient view. Patients may compensate for the vertical eye deviation by slightly tucking their chin down. When tilting the head to the right, the diplopia will be the same as in a right fourth nerve palsy, with the right eye being hypertrophic due to the action of the right superior rectus. When tilting the head to the left, again the diplopia will be maximal, but now the left eye is hypertrophic due to the left superior rectus action. This alternating hypertropia and worsening of diplopia on head tilting to either side is termed a positive double Bielschowsky's head tilt test. There will also be an alternating ipsilateral hypertropia on contralateral horizontal gaze when the head is in neutral position due to the unopposed action of the ipsilateral inferior oblique. This is not shown in the analogy. In summary, fourth nerve palsies lead to varying degrees of vertical and torsional diplopia due to the loss of the superior oblique muscle. At rest, this leads to the ipsilateral eye being extorted and hypertrophic, with diplopia worsening on contralateral gaze due to the unopposed ipsilateral inferior oblique, and on ipsilateral head tilting due to unopposed ipsilateral superior rectus action. Bilateral fourth nerve palsies share the same characteristics on both sides, with diplopia worsening on alternating horizontal gaze and head tilt.